Hi all, good to see you. I'm Clem Ullman here. Our website is CWOWI.EU. It stands for Church Without Walls International. And we are located in Europe, in the Netherlands to be precise. Welcome. Today's message is about that we are seated in heavenly places. Okay, by the way, I want to mention, if you want to go to our website, you can find a lot of articles there. A lot of articles about house church, about living, having church, being the church in relationship with other friends and family. And you can go to YouTube, find more of my teachings, and on Facebook, of course. But today, about seated in heavenly places. We all know who is seated in heavenly places, that our Lord is seated there. And why I want to share this, because it's so on my heart, and I see so many Christians and hear about them that feel that are defeated. They feel they are defeated. They know in their mind that God is high above everything, that He has the highest name. They know that He is seated at the right hand of the Father. But it's not a reality in their life, and it doesn't do anything in their lives. And they have the idea, yeah, okay, God is high and He's seated high or whatever. But the devil is very, he is very strong too. And he's just a little bit below God, below Christ. But that is not the truth. And so I want to share something with you about how that Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father in heavenly places, how He got up there, what He did, you know, that He really got the victory, and then some other truth that is part number two, so to speak. But first, I have a lot of scriptures for you to share. So if you have your Bible with you, go to Acts chapter 2, and there you can read about, of course, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And then at a certain point, Peter stood up, he explained what had happened. And then when you read verse 23, he says, they crucified Christ and they put Him to death, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that He should be held by it. And then Peter says that God would raise Christ up to sit on His throne, and that God exalted Him to the right hand of God. Wow, so not only did God raise Jesus up, but He exalted Him to the right hand of God. And then in verse 34, he quotes an Old Testament prophecy from David, and you can find the prophecy in Psalm 110, first verse. It says, the Lord said to my Lord, the Lord Father said to my Lord, to Christ, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Sit at my right hand till I make your enemies my footstool. What does that mean? Well, when you look it up, what does it mean to my footstool, or sit at my right hand? Well, in Joshua 10, you can read a story about Joshua, of course, and about five Amorite kings that they were captured by Joshua, and he brought them to Joshua. And then Joshua said to the captains of the men who went with him, come near, put your feet on the neck of these kings. And he drew them near and put their feet on their necks. Putting their feet on their neck was an ancient custom for victorious kings who put their feet on the necks of the conquered enemy. So that's actually what Peter here is saying. You know, he conquered the enemy. He made till your enemies, what the Lord has said, at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. When something is your footstool, you put your feet on top of it, right? So that means He conquered Satan. How did He do that? In Colossians chapter 2, you can read about it. It says in verse 15 that He disarmed principalities and power, and that He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. In it is the cross. Some other translations say, He put them openly to shame and He exposed them to public disgrace by leading them in a triumphal parade. So Satan was completely humiliated. He was disarmed. He doesn't have any arms anymore, any weapons anymore. His only weapon is his mouth to lie and to deceive us, actually. But that is what our Lord did. So he made a public spectacle of them. There was a public for the angels and for everyone to see how what Jesus had done and how Satan was disarmed and how He conquered Satan, how He was triumphing over Satan through the cross. Well, amazing. And Philippians chapter 2 in verse 8 and 9, it says, Christ humbled himself and he became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. And therefore, because he humbled himself, God has highly exalted him and gave him the name which is above every name. And highly exalted suggests an exaltation to the highest position, a super exalted position, a position of honor and glory. You know, it's an elevation above all others, above all others. Amazing. When you go to Ephesians, you can read about that too. In that, you can read about the prayers of Paul for the saints, and then he prays in first chapter, verse 18 to 21. Paul prays and he says, I pray that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. Wow. And he seated him at his right hand in heavenly places. So he raised him from the dead and he seated him at his right hand in heavenly places. Why, amazing. It says he highly exalted him in Philippians. Highly exalted is an exaltation to the highest position. And then he says here, far above. Oh, I want you to read that verse 21. Okay, it doesn't say just above. No, it says he is raised far above all principalities and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. Christ is seated far above. You think Satan is here and God and Christ is there? No, no, no. He is raised far above principalities. I have a lot of words. I looked them up what it means. Principalities in Greek is the word arche. And it denotes rulers of the highest level. It refers to all human rulers, including kings and politicians, also to angelic beings. So the natural and the spiritual realm are both under the dominion of Jesus Christ. And there's absolutely no one more highly exalted than him. Then it says far above powers. That's the word exousias. It describes people who have received delegated power, often translated as authorities. And in this context, it refers to people who hold public office and wield authority entrusted to them by their superiors or through an election. So Jesus has a rank that's even higher than most powerful human authorities. And he's seated far above every might. It's the word dunamis, explosive power. But the word dunamis is also used to describe the full strength of a military force. So Jesus is even above all the military forces in the world today. He is seated far above every dominion. Dominions is the word in Greek, kuriotes, which means lordships. It could refer to any world system, to any political, financial, or any system or any type. So there is no system in the whole world that is more high ranking than the Lord Jesus Christ. And he is not seated just above, but he is seated far above. And finally, to make sure Paul has included everything and everyone on his list, he added, and he is seated far above every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. Why? Just think about it. That God raised him from the dead and he seated him at his right hand, far above everything I just mentioned you and I've just read. So Jesus is literally Lord over all. That is amazing, Lord. That's a wonderful Lord we have. But when you go back to Ephesians, there's even more good news. When we read in verse 21, far above, and then we named principalities, power, my dominions, every name. And in verse 22, it says, and he put all things or all under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Wow, the church is his body. He is the head. The church is his body. So everything, what I mentioned here, what you can read here, is under the foot of the body. And we are the body. It's under us. And we are seated high above too. Wow, when you go to Ephesians 2. I see my time is limited. Go to chapter 2. You are already here in verse 4. It says, but God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love, which he loved us even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. He made us alive together. In Romans it says that we are buried baptism, or I have to read it. Romans 6, verse 4. It says, we were buried with him through baptism into death. So through your baptism, you were buried into death, but you were raised. It says here that you are raised. When we were dead in trespass, he made us alive together with Christ. He raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Wow. So when Christ was raised, you were raised. When he was seated at the right hand of the Father, you are seated at the right hand of the Father. The Bible and Paul explains it, that we are in Christ. So when Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father, far above every principality, every power, every name that is named, he's far above it. It means you are in Christ and you are seated high above it too. So why are you defeated? Why are you so afraid of devil and demons? Why do you think, oh yeah, God is mighty, but who am I? Yeah, maybe not in the natural, but spiritually speaking, you are in Christ and you are seated far above. Wow. Colossians 3, verse 1 and 2. I want to read that too. Where is Colossians? Let's go there. Colossians 3, verse 1 and 2. It says, if then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God, and set your mind on things above and not on the things of the earth. Okay, so capture it in your mind. You are not below, but you are high above. So when you pray, pray from that position that you are high above. When you worship, worship from that position that you are seated at the right hand of the Father. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Wow, and that's why Paul prayed in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. He says, I pray that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. The power of his resurrection. It's not anything that you have done, but Christ did it. But he loved us so much that we were in his mind already in him. So when he died, we died with him because we were in him. When he was raised, we were in him. We were raised with him. When he was seated at the right hand of the Father, we were there in him. And we are still there in him. We are the body. He is the head. And of course, the head gives the direction, but we as the body, we have authority too. It's a cooperation, the head and the body together. Body without a head doesn't do anything, can't do anything, right? But a head without a body is also very limited, right? So picture that in your mind and think about it. Ask the Father for revelation. When you feel like you are defeated, you are a nobody, why would God listen to your prayers? Why would the devil listen to you when you say, get away from me, Satan? Because you don't know right now where you are positioned, that Christ seated you at the right hand of the Father, who you are in him. You are far above. Think about it this next week, okay? And hope to see you next week. Bye-bye.